the hits.
Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. This program is aimed at English learners. So we speak a little slower, and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English.
Today on the program, you will hear from Dan Friedel, Gregory Stockel, and Brian Lynn. Later, Steve Ember will present our American history series, The Making of a Nation. But first, here is Dan Friedel.
Cars are collecting more information about how people drive and what they are doing while they drive. The cars gather information about the music their drivers listen to, and their good and bad driving habits. More cars with computer processors and internet connections are getting on the road. The data they collect is valuable to car manufacturers and also information technology companies. In Europe, European Commission officials are reportedly calling for rules about how car makers should make information available to others in the car business. For example, car repair shops, insurance companies, and leasing companies all want information collected from drivers. But in some cases, large car makers seem unsure about sharing that data with other companies. One critic said the car makers are gatekeepers who will make money by charging others for access. If they charge too much, they will restrict competition. Independent repair shops, for example, are worried that they will not be able to fix cars if they cannot look at the information stored by a car's computer. Instead, drivers will be required to go to service centers owned by the manufacturer. Sylvia Gotson leads a trade group called FIGIFA, which represents repair shops and car parts makers in Europe. She said, car makers get the full amount of data available while businesses she represents get crumbs. But European car makers say they need to protect drivers by restricting how much information they share. A spokesperson for the European Automobile Manufacturers Association said, uncontrolled access is a safety and personal data security threat. Stellantis, General Motors, and Volkswagen are car manufacturers that plan to make money from driver data. Some will create computer programs drivers can buy. BMW does not agree that it is restricting access. If drivers give permission, the German automaker says it can share 100 data points or kinds of information with independent organizations. But the FIGIFA said today's cars produce thousands of data points. BMW said it would like to have a meeting organized by a group such as the European Commission to make a list of car data points that everyone can agree on. The chief of Stellantis gave an example of how data from its cars can help cities become safer. He said his company can look at data created by a car's brakes and then tell a city which intersections on its streets cause the most emergency stops. But he added, that kind of research can be costly. Another way to use the data is to find ways to reward good drivers. Car makers can send information such as how fast a car brakes and how often it speeds up, to insurance companies. That information can be used to reduce insurance costs for good drivers. There are also car sharing companies that are independent, and those that are owned by large auto companies. The independent companies say they want to be sure they are paying the same amount for data as the others. Nicolas Jeanmart leads Insurance Europe. He said the car makers need to let the drivers control who gets their data. You cannot leave this in the hands of car manufacturers, he said. I'm Dan Friedel.
Leonora Buenviaje has been making women's clothes out of waste materials, usually dresses. She says wearing clothes made from waste materials can be both economical and look good. Buenviaje is 51 years old and from Cainta in the Philippines, about 15 kilometers east of the capital, Manila. To make her dresses, she uses a foot-operated sewing machine to join together the waste materials. These include recycled newspapers, plastic wrapping, and rice sacks. Recycling is when something new is made from something that has been used before. The process Buenviaje uses to join the materials together is called sewing. Sewing combines two pieces of cloth or is used to repair cloth. She creates new and beautiful clothes women can wear. They are sometimes completed with a piece called a headdress that goes on top of the head. The bubble wraps from delivery packages are nice looking and make for a good design, especially the black and white wraps, she said. Bubble wrap is a plastic product that is used to protect goods that are being delivered. She said white bubble wraps were good for making wedding dresses. The dresses sell for between $30 to $50. They are used for everything from coming-of-age parties for a woman's 18th birthday, called debuts, to weddings. In Asia, there is plenty of waste material for Buenviaje to work with. About 80% of the world ocean plastic is estimated to come from Asian rivers. A 2021 report by Oxford University's online publication, Our World in Data, found that the Philippines is responsible for 1/3 of Asia's ocean plastic pollution. It's important to recycle or utilize used materials so we can help our earth, said Lalaine Alcalde, who buys clothes from Buenviaje. Buenviaje said the recycled materials used for each dress depend on what her buyers are looking for. She said her dresses are used in beauty competitions and are popular with young girls. I get delighted whenever they win. The designs are simple, but they still win, she said. I'm Gregory Stockel.
Some Muslim students in southern India have chosen to stay away from school rather than obey a ban on hijabs. The hijab ban began in January at a government-run junior college in the city of Udupi in Karnataka province. The junior college is similar to a high school in the United States. Some students protested the ban by staying outside and attempted to hold classes there. They argued that Muslim students had long been permitted to wear hijabs at school. More schools in the state soon ordered similar bans. This led to demonstrations by hundreds of Muslim women and counter-protests held by Hindu students. The hijab head covering is worn by many Muslim women to show modesty or as a sign of their religious belief. Opponents consider it a sign of oppression that is forced upon women. That idea is rejected by hijab supporters. They say it has different meanings for different people, including as an expression of Muslim identity. Six students brought a legal case to have the bans overturned, arguing that they violated their rights to education and religious freedom. But on March 15th, an Indian court upheld the ban. In its ruling, the court said it did not consider the hijab a necessary practice of Islam. The issue has started new debates over the rights of Muslims in India. Muslims make up 14% of the country's 1.4 billion people. Muslim groups have accused the government of pushing them aside as a minority in the population. They see restrictions on hijabs as a worrying sign of Hindu nationalism under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Modi's Bharatiya Janata Party rules the state of Karnataka. Aliya Asadi is a student in the state. When she was 12, she wore a hijab while representing the state at a karate competition. She won gold at the event. But when she recently tried to wear the head covering to her junior college, she was blocked from entering. "It's not just a piece of cloth," Asadi told the Associated Press. "Hijab is my identity, and right now what they're doing is taking away my identity from me," she said. To reduce tensions in the state, officials closed schools and colleges for 3 days. They then ordered a statewide ban on the hijab in classes. The state's order said religious clothing in government-run schools disturbs equality, integrity, and public law and order. Some students gave in and attended with their heads uncovered. Others refused and have been barred from school for nearly 2 months. One of those students is 18-year-old Aisha Anwar from Udupi. She said she has missed tests and is falling behind in her schoolwork. "I feel like we are being let down by everyone," Anwar told the AP. Aisha Imtiaz, another student barred from school, said she wears the hijab as a sign of devotion to Islam. But the 20-year-old noted that opinions differ on the issue even among Muslim women. There are so many of my friends who do not wear a hijab inside the classroom, Imtiaz said. She added, they feel empowered in their own way, and I feel empowered in my own way. I'm Brian Lynn.
Welcome to The Making of a Nation, American History in VOA Special English. I'm Steve Ember. Britain was once the most powerful nation in the world. It ruled a far-reaching empire. We look at how British power gave way to American influence after World War II. One can almost name the day when this happened. It was February 21st, 1947. British diplomats in Washington called the State Department. They had two messages from their government. The first was about Greece. The situation there was critical. Greece had been occupied by Germany during the war. Now it was split by a bitter civil war. On one side of the fighting was the Greek royal family, supported by Britain. On the other side were communist-led rebels, supported by Yugoslavia and the Soviet Union. British forces had helped keep Greece from becoming communist at the end of World War II. A few years later, Britain could no longer help. It needed all its strength to rebuild after the war. So on that February day in 1947, Britain told the United States it would soon end all support for Greece. Britain's second message that day was about Turkey. Turkey was stronger than Greece, but the concern was that it too could become communist unless it received outside help. Britain warned the United States that the Soviet Union would soon extend its control all the way across Eastern Europe to the Eastern Mediterranean. It called on President Harry Truman to provide strong American support to help Greece and Turkey resist the communist threat. Britain, in effect, was asking the United States to take over leadership of the Western world. The United States was ready to accept this new responsibility. For months, relations between the United States and the Soviet Union had been growing worse and worse. The two countries had fought together as allies in the Second World War. But Soviet actions after the war shocked the American people. The Soviet Union wanted to block Western political and economic influence in Central and Eastern Europe. It wanted to extend its own influence instead. So after the war, it forced a number of countries to establish communist governments.
From Stettin in the Baltic to Trieste in the Adriatic, an iron curtain has descended across the continent.
Britain's Prime Minister Winston Churchill described the situation in a speech in March of 1946 at Westminster College in the American state of Missouri.
Behind that line lie all the capitals of the ancient states of Central and Eastern Europe. Warsaw, Berlin, Prague, Vienna, Budapest, Belgrade, Bucharest, and Sofia. All these famous cities and the populations around them lie in what I must call the Soviet sphere. And all our subjects, in one form or another, not only to Soviet influence, but to a very high and in some cases increasing measure of control from Moscow.
Churchill warned that the Soviet Union was trying to expand its power. He described it as an iron curtain falling across the middle of Europe. This iron curtain divided Europe into a communist East and a democratic West. The situation was made even more tense by news coming from China. China was a divided nation at the end of World War II. The forces of nationalist leader Chiang Kai-shek controlled the southwestern part of the country. Communist forces under Mao Zedong controlled the north. Both the United States and the Soviet Union expected that Chiang Kai-shek would be able to unite China. Chiang and the Nationalists won several early victories over the Communists, but Mao and his forces used a growing hatred of the Nationalist government to win support. Slowly, they began to win battles and capture arms. Early in 1949, Communist forces took control of Peking, now Beijing, and Tianjin. They captured Shanghai and Canton. By the end of the year, Chiang and his nationalist forces had to flee to the island of Taiwan. The fall of the nationalist government on the mainland caused a bitter political debate in America. Some critics of the Truman administration thought the United States had not done enough to help the Nationalists. The Truman administration rejected the charges. It said Chiang caused his own defeat by failing to reform and win the support of the Chinese people. Secretary of State Dean Acheson described the defeat this way. The unfortunate but inescapable fact is that the ominous result of the civil war in China was beyond the control of the government of the United States. Nothing that this country did or could have done within the reasonable limits of its capabilities could have changed that result. Nothing that was left undone by this country has contributed to it. It was the product of internal Chinese forces, forces which this country tried to influence but could not. A decision was arrived at within China, if only a decision by default. The United States was more successful in its policies toward Europe. The British warnings about the communist threat in Greece and Turkey led President Truman to speak to Congress. He said, "I believe that it must be the policy of the United States to support free peoples who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures." Truman called on Congress to give him $400 million in aid for Greece and Turkey. After a brief but intense national debate, Congress agreed. Truman then launched an effort to save the Greek economy and reorganize the Greek army. Soon after that, Yugoslavia and the Soviet Union ended their aid to Greek rebels. The civil war in Greece ended. American help for Greece and Turkey was the first step in what became known as the Truman Doctrine. The goal of this policy was to stop Soviet aggression anywhere in the world. Truman was willing to use military force to stop the spread of communism, but he also believed it was equally important to build up Western European nations so they would be strong enough to defend themselves. Europe was suffering terribly after World War II. There were severe shortages of food and fuel. Crops were destroyed. Many Europeans were beginning to look to the communists, to anybody, to save them. This is one reason why Truman and his advisors developed a plan to rebuild the economies of Europe. After the war, President Truman made George Marshall his Secretary of State. Marshall had led American troops as a general in World War II. Now, as the nation's top diplomat, he proposed the idea for rebuilding Europe. This idea became known as the Marshall Plan. President Truman explained why there had to be a Marshall Plan. People were starving, he said. There had been food riots in France and Italy. There was not enough fuel. People were cold and sick. Tuberculosis was breaking out. As Truman said later, something had to be done. Secretary of State Marshall described the plan during a congressional hearing in Washington.
Why must the United States carry so great a load in helping Europe? The answer is simple. The United States is the only country in the world today which has the economic power and productivity to furnish the needed assistance. The 6 8/10 billion proposed for the first 15 months is less than a single month's charge of the war. To be quite clear, this unprecedented endeavor of the new world to help the old is neither sure nor easy. It is a calculated risk. It is a difficult program. And you know far better than I do the political difficulties involved in this program. But there's no doubt whatever in my mind that if we decide to do this thing, we can do it successfully. And there's also no doubt in my mind that the whole world hangs in the balance as to what it is to be.
The United States offered aid through the Marshall Plan to all countries in Europe. The Soviet Union and its allies refused help. 16 other countries, however, welcomed the aid. From 1948 to 1952, administrators of the Marshall Plan worked with these countries. The United States spent $13 billion. The plan worked. Agricultural production in Marshall Plan countries increased by 10%. Industrial production increased by 35%. Production in some industries, such as steel, increased by much more. There were political results as well. Stronger economies helped prevent communists from gaining control of the governments in France and Italy. Some Europeans criticized the Marshall Plan. They said it increased tensions between the United States and the Soviet Union in the years after the war. Yet few could deny that the plan was one of the most successful international economic programs in history.
And that's our program for today. Listen again tomorrow to learn English through stories from around the world. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.